Amen. So, over the last couple of weeks, we have been going through the book of Ephesians in the New Testament. This is a letter written by the Apostle Paul, a leader in the early church, written while he was in prison for preaching the gospel of Jesus. He's writing through a group of house churches, small communities scattered across a large multicultural city in what's now modern-day Turkey. But in the first century, it was a Roman colony, an outpost of the Roman Empire. Over the last few weeks, we've seen two main themes begin to emerge through this letter, and that is identity and calling. Paul is encouraging the church, this is who God has made you to be. And here's how he's calling you to live in light of that identity. He describes this new identity, that anyone who is a follower of Jesus is a saint, an adopted child of God, daughters and sons made holy in God's sight. And Paul's desire for them is to have the eyes of their hearts opened so they can know God's love by the revelation of his Holy Spirit. That's your identity, saints. Adopted into one family, loved by God. So tonight we're going to dig a little bit deeper into the second of these two themes, the calling side of it. If God has made us to be saints adopted into his family, how are we supposed to live in light of that identity? Let me start tonight with a question for you. How do you feel about family gatherings? Those times of year like Christmas and Easter where everyone gets together around the dinner table. Maybe those are really nice occasions. You get to see the family you've not seen in ages, have a laugh, have some food, have a drink, have a good time. Or maybe for some of us, the idea of getting the family together is just completely unimaginable. Families can be messy and complex, and there's social divisions and social tensions, and sometimes really painful family history. You might have gotten to a point with your family where you think, we're just too different. I can't see how we can relate to each other anymore. So if we're going to talk about the church being a family, if we are adopted daughters and sons of God, we can have good or bad feelings associated with that language. For some, the church is an incredible community that displays just what it is to be family in a more complete way than anywhere else. For me, my younger brother is severely autistic, and our extended family have never really quite wrapped their heads around exactly what that means for him and for us as a family. They think he's just being naughty or misbehaving, so rather than kind of spending Christmas dinner with our extended family, me, my parents, and my brother would always go to our church on Christmas Day, and we'd invite anyone and everyone to have a meal with us. And it always felt like this is the kind of family the church can be. It can be a more complete and welcoming family than even our own flesh and blood. But let's face it, the church doesn't always get this right. Sometimes the church makes a mockery of being a family because we treat each other so poorly. We don't live up to the calling. The church being a family is hard because it's full of messy, broken, and complex people. So at this point in Ephesians, Paul begins to talk really pragmatically about the tensions that can arise in a church community. He's writing to churches in a city filled with Romans, Jews, Greeks, and as many other cultures as a large, diverse city in the Roman Empire would be home to. He's writing to people that even though they've started following Jesus, they come from all sorts of different backgrounds of religious worship. Roman gods, Greek gods, as well as the Jewish faith that Paul himself comes from. He's also writing through a group of people from different social and economic backgrounds. These church communities will have been filled with both the rich and the poor, the powerful and the downcast, There will even be slaves and slave owners, all who have come to follow Jesus and are now trying to figure out what their lives look like now that they're one family of God. Paul is well aware that with such a mix of people, there will be tensions and fractures and hostility in the church. And that if this diverse group of people is going to be called a family, it's going to require some serious work. So he writes to the church, "For Jesus himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility." One new humanity. This is the vision. This is a key part of the identity and calling of the church. We are one new humanity, one family of God, called to live in unity with each other. I think this is a passage that transfers really easily from the first century to the 21st. In a world that continues to be marked with racial hostility and injustice and fragmentation, when we've had riots in our streets from white nationalists burning down hotels that are housing refugees seeking asylum, this is a passage that speaks right to the heart of what it looks like for us to be saints of God, his church, to be a presence of reconciliation, as we ourselves are brought together in the gospel of Jesus. We have a vision here of what happens when the gospel gets hold of people groups who are divided. What happens when God transforms the lives of individuals who are divided by tensions of race and ethnicity and are unified as one family in the love and grace of God. So what does this look like in Paul's first century context? What's God doing in Ephesus, and how might he be speaking to us today in our context of 21st century London? Well, Paul is speaking primarily here, I think, to his Jewish brothers and sisters, the people of Israel, because this idea of being the family of God goes way, way back to the Old Testament. In Genesis, right at the start of the Bible, God raises himself up, the nation of Israel, to be his partners in a covenant relationship. He says to a man named Abraham, "Your descendants will be like the stars in the sky, and that you will be my people, and I will be your God." And the plan is that through this partnership with one people, the whole world will come to know God's goodness and glory. But Israel are time and time again unfaithful to that covenant partnership. They chase after other gods and their own aims. So God would speak through through a group of people called the prophets, and he would give them the message to speak to Israel, to the people of God, and call them back to that covenant partnership. And there's a point where God says to the prophet Isaiah, a line that I absolutely love, "It is too small a thing for you to be my servant to restore the tribes of Israel. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach the ends of the earth." Gentiles is just a catch-all term for anyone who's not Jewish. So there's Jews and then the rest of the world kind of under the bracket of Gentiles. So God is saying, it's not enough for me to just have one nation. It's too small a thing for my salvation to be just kept for one group of people. My glory can't just be contained by one race or one ethnicity. My glory can't just be kept back for one people. His glory extends to every nation on earth. That's his plan, that through partnership with one small group of people, the whole world will be blessed to come and know the joy of a life lived with God. So how will God accomplish this? How will God bring about this unity of one family, of his adopted daughters and sons? Well, let's go back to our passage in Ephesians. Paul says that Jesus has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commandments, with its commands and regulations. He's destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility between Jews and Gentiles. He's broken down the divides between different ethnic groups. What does Paul mean by that? What walls is he talking about? Well, this is a fun one for any history or archaeology nerds. In the Jewish temple in Jerusalem, there was a literal dividing wall between Jews and Gentiles. The temple in Jerusalem was culturally segregated. In the inner circle of the temple, you've got the Holy of Holies, the innermost circle, the place where God is said to dwell most richly. If you sin and if you want to make yourself right with God, priests will have to go in there for you and make sacrifices to repair your relationship with God, to pay the cost for the wrong thing you've done. It's separated off by a big curtain. And then you get the next ring moving outwards, which is for Jewish men. Then you get another circle for Jewish women. And at the bottom of the order, you get Gentiles, everyone else. So God's presence is at the center, separated by a curtain. And then you get layers moving outwards, separated by dividing walls of who's allowed to get close to God. So it goes priests, Jewish men, Jewish women, then everyone else. This temple in Jerusalem has been destroyed now by the Roman Empire in around 70 AD. But we still have fragments of those dividing walls. In fact, there are two warning signs remaining, one in a museum in Istanbul, one in a museum in Jerusalem. And they give the instruction to Gentiles that none of them can pass beyond this point of the dividing wall, and that this would be punishable by death if they did. So Gentiles really aren't allowed in the inner circle of the temple. They can stay on the fringes of God's house, outside the dividing wall. So this is what Paul says Jesus does when he dies on the cross, that he breaks down the dividing walls that separate the different ethnic groups in the church. This is really interesting because it says in the Gospels that when Jesus dies, the curtain in the temple that separated off the Holy of Holies was torn in two, showing that we don't need to be separated from God's presence anymore, that when we mess up and make mistakes and we sin, that we don't need to bring a sacrifice to the temple anymore, because God has provided the perfect sacrifice by paying the cost with his very own blood. He set aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. We don't need to make sacrifices anymore. The perfect one has been provided. But here Paul is saying that it's not just the temple curtain that is torn in two, it's the dividing walls as well. The work that Jesus does on the cross isn't just for one group of people, it's for everyone. There's no more dividing walls between Jew and Gentile, but each of you have access to God equally. There's no segregation in the temple, but Jesus died for every single one of you. Each of you are given the gift of salvation. You are all equally cherished and beloved parts of God's one family, one humanity. So I just want to spend the kind of next 5-10 minutes looking at a few practical lessons we can take from this passage. That if our identity is to be one family, one new humanity, how do we live out that calling to see the walls that divide us broken down as we live in unity? Well, the first thing that we need to understand is that racial reconciliation is integral to the gospel, not an added bonus. I'm still quite new to the church, and from what I gather, this is something that has been a real priority for the family of St. Paul's, and that is absolutely brilliant. But I think what's important here, though, is that we remember the reason we look for racial reconciliation is not simply because it's a nice idea. We don't look for diversity just because it's high on the political radar at the minute. You can find diversity in all sorts of places. You could go through a Beyoncé concert and find people of every skin color speaking every language that we could think of. And that's brilliant, that is great, but we're not just chasing diversity because it's nice. Because the danger here is that if we look for racial reconciliation because it's a nice idea or because it's on our political radar at the minute, eventually we'll forget about it. I think this is something we've seen with things like the Black Lives Matter movement over time, is where really tragically, Black Lives Matter will get a resurgence every time there's a big public injustice. When we have an instance like George Floyd in 2020 and there's mass protests, but eventually, and I do think that this is, I'm kind of speaking to myself and people of my kind of demographic here, eventually it drops out of public consciousness again. Unless you are directly affected by it, if you are privileged enough to not be directly affected by this on a regular basis, on a day-to-day basis, there is a danger that it drops out of the public consciousness until another big event happens again and the public gets reminded that it's important. But if we are followers of Jesus, racial justice isn't an optional extra. It's not something we can allow to drop off the radar, because being one unified family of God is part of the gospel. Jesus' work on the cross doesn't just tear the temple curtain and give access to God, it breaks down dividing walls, giving us peace with each other as well. You might well have seen some lovely, cheesy Christian art, just like this one. That our sin separates us from God, and Jesus provides a bridge to close the gap. And that's true. That is really good. Lovely, cheesy Christian art like this is fantastic. But if that's the only way we think of the cross, we are missing half the picture. One commentator, Rich Velodis, puts it like this: the cross of Christ isn't just a bridge that gets us to God. It's a sledgehammer that tears down the walls that separate us. Reconciliation between fractured groups of people is integral to the work that Jesus does on the cross, so we can't let it slip off our radar. We need a complete picture of the gospel. The second thing, being part of the unified family of God means we need to resist the drift towards the mirror. Friends, there is comfort in familiarity. It's a really easy thing and something that will impact every single one of us. But left to our own devices, we will always drift towards what is familiar, towards what fits us or suits us well. We are creatures of habit that will drift towards the same music, the same artwork, the same literature, the same TV shows, the aspects of culture that are familiar to us. In the church, it's true in the life of the church as well. We are drawn towards expressions of prayer that make us feel comfortable. We are drawn to expressions of worship that, generally speaking, mesh with whatever culture we are from. Even in our outreach and the people we share the gospel with, statistically, we are more likely to share it with someone of our own demographic than anyone else. The vast majority of the Church of England, the denomination that we are part of here at St. Paul's, even in churches that have tried to make racial justice a priority, are still overwhelmingly white middle class. In Ealing, in the last census taken by the Office for National Statistics, about 45% of this borough of London is something identified as something other than white British. So while this part of London is kind of still 55% majority white, is our church community reflective of the demographic of the area in which we are situated? As I say, I know this church has really looked to prioritize racial justice over the last few years, so I'm saying this as part of a really positive process. But perhaps this is something we need to think of as a goal to work towards. That in our mission and our sharing of God's kingdom, we don't just share the good news of Jesus with people who are just like us, but we reach across the boundaries of our comfort zones. Like that passage in Isaiah, it is too small a thing for God's kingdom to be limited to just one nation. But this is a kingdom that reaches the ends of the earth. We resist the drift towards the mirror. And finally, being a unified family of God means being a community that is defined by repentance and forgiveness. There will always be points where we get this wrong until the new creation comes and God says, "Behold, I am making all things new." There will always be points where we mess this up and old sins of prejudice come up and we treat people and think of people who are different to ourselves as something less than our brothers and sisters in Christ. We treat each other as strangers, not as family. But I think we will always be heading in the right direction if we are willing and able to consistently come before God and offer him our mistakes and offer him our prejudices. There's a great prayer that King David writes in Psalm 139. "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Friends, I think prayers like this are the way we make continuous progress towards racial reconciliation in the church. This is at the heart of being one unified family of God, is not to expect that there'll never be sins that come up, but to routinely place ourselves before the Lord and pray, "Search me. Show me where I'm going wrong. Show me where I've acted or spoken in a way that has made somebody else feel like an outsider. Show me where I've acted or spoken in a way that doesn't treat someone like family." If we offer up these prayers to God with sincerity and integrity, we'll be moving in the right direction. We repent of our blind spots, we repent of our stereotypes, we repent of our biases and the unspoken assumptions we carry about other people because of the color of their skin. And it's as we repent and turn from those sins that we are one unified family of God. It's in that practice of repentance and forgiveness that we can say, as Paul said to the Ephesians, that Christ himself is our peace. Because it's the grace he shows us in taking those sins and nailing them to the cross that the divisions and fractures between us are healed and restored. We are a family defined by grace, a family united by forgiveness.